The meeting this evening is an opportunity for the school board to present to the town council their proposals, their recommendation, ideas on the kindergarten wing and renovations at the high school. This really is the first opportunity that they've had to sit down and give us an in-depth analysis of what's going on. I would like to thank all members of the school board for their efforts on this, the members of the committee that studied this, and Marie in particular. And I know Marie will do the appropriate kudos to all the folks that worked with her on it. So with that, Marie, the show is all yours, and we appreciate you coming and sharing this with us.
Good evening, everyone, and especially to the parents of all the 7th graders. We will start this meeting and break it into 4 parts tonight. The first part of our meeting will be Tom Frisella, Paulina Portria, Elaine Maloney, and myself. And we have put together a list of questions and answers that we have received throughout this whole process. And we felt that the questions that we're going to ask and the answers that we're going to give have been part of what has been coming up for the last few years in studying this process with 2 committees. The second part of our meeting, we have 9 very special 7th graders here tonight who will do a presentation that they have done working on their laptops in school. And this was a project that they were given to do in 1 week for us. The third part of our meeting, we have Bob Howe, the architect from HKTA, and he is here to go through the details of the projects, of both projects, that are in the packets that all of the town council members and the school board members received prior to this meeting. And lastly, we will open up for discussion with questions, concerns, whatever, between the school board and the town council. We will be taping the first 3 sections of this meeting tonight. Our intent is to replay this tape on our cable channel so that we will be able to inform and educate the community as to the progress of both of these projects. Our main goal for this evening is to cover the whys for the high school project and the addition to Pond Cove. We are not looking for a yes or a no answer. We're only looking for your understanding of what the projects are and how necessary they are to the future of our students and our community. This process started 3 years ago, and in 3 years we have had 2 committees, the original facilities committee and the building advisory committee. Tonight we have a lot of those members that were on each of those committees in this room, all of the administrators, various school board members, various town council members, and the 2 parents who have stuck with us for the past 3 years, Sue Pierce and Diane Nicholson. Based on the recommendations from these committees, the school board is now asking for your support for both of these projects. We realize that difficult decisions will have to be made, and we know our request comes at a very challenging economic time. We hope to gain your understanding and support for each of these projects and know that it will take a lot of conversations amongst all of us over the next few months. If we move to the first question, we ask what attracts people to live in Cape Elizabeth. In January of 2002, the town mailed a survey to 138 new property owners who purchased their property within that previous year. When asked the reasons why they moved to Cape Elizabeth, the number one reason stated was the proximity to the oceans and parks, followed by the reputation of the schools. However, in the households with children, the number one reason by far was the reputation of the schools. Are larger families moving to Cape Elizabeth? Based on that same survey, it is clear that larger families are moving into our community. The families moving out averaged about 2.4 people per household, while those families moving in averaged about 2.9 per household. Could this account for the increases in students we are seeing throughout Pond Cove and the middle school in the past couple of years? We currently have over 30 students more than we were projected to for the year 2002. This graph shows that since the early 70s, we began to see a decline in enrollment until about 1986, when the trend began to reverse itself. Since then, we have seen a steady increase, and while that increase leveled off somewhat in 1996, we have begun to see a slight rise over the past 2 years. Ironically, we are seeing these increases occur in spite of the lower projections provided to us by planning decisions, a firm that we hired from South Portland to do our population survey. If we continue to exceed those projections, our enrollment could remain stable throughout the next 10 years rather than the decline that has been projected. So if you see the fuchsia colored line is where the projected enrollment was going, and we are slightly above that. The important point to remember here is that the classroom space that was available to our students 10, 20, and 30 years ago is no longer available to them. We are facing the same overcrowding that we faced in the early 90s. This time, it's because of changing program needs. We will not have available classrooms at Pond Cove in the next 10 years in which to move the kindergartners.
The next question that often comes up has to do with the kindergarten, why the kindergarten is at the high school. And in 1992, many of you that were involved with the conditions and the project at that time, there was overcrowding on Cove, and there was space available at the high school. And I think according to the school board minutes in October of that year, the actual enrollment of the high school when the vote was taken to move the kindergarten was 396 students. So at that time, obviously, there was room at the high school. Conversations at that time also revealed that in the long term, eventually, as you looked at the numbers of students that were at that time in kindergarten, first grade, and preschool, that in 10 years or so, there would be a problem. Here we are 10 years or so down the road, and we need that space. Also at that time, there was discussion in terms of the project and the renovations that were needed K through 8. The cost of adding on any more space was something that was out of the question. That there was a desire to not add any additional classroom space as part of the Pond Cove Middle School project. Also, what's happened in recent years was the move of community services. And the question here is how we as a school district benefited from the move of community services out of the middle school basement. One of the biggest reasons, one of the biggest causes for us has been the increase in storage space. Not only by vacating and allowing us to place classrooms at that level, community services use storage throughout the district, at the high school, at the middle school, at the elementary school. There were storage closets that all opened up because they took all of their stuff with them. In the original facilities committee, one of the biggest issues was that there just was a lack of storage space. Also, we gained some, I think right below where we are right now, we're able to store our district-wide paper all in this building, which has really helped in terms of the project decrease the need of additional storage space in that project. Presently, the middle school is using that space where community service used to occupy for a language arts classroom, and even when community services was still in that building, we actually took over one of the classrooms while they were there, which limited their program. We have a health classroom that's located in that area. Our world language teachers moved from classroom to classroom. This gave them a space to put their supplies and their materials. They did not have their own classroom. It's also a space for our professional development, which in recent years, especially with the learning results and the requirements under that law, it gives us a space for our professional development and curriculum materials, and a place just to put all of that, those materials that we have related to those areas. The project that you'll be seeing this evening, that space in that lower level was an area where the seventh graders could work with their laptops in creating the project. It allowed them to spread out to do that special project. It's also an area where we have much needed space for pet conferences, when we have meetings with parents required by law. It's another space that we can use to have those meetings. And lastly, our life skills special education program has grown. The needs of many of our multi-handicapped children to have that kitchen space, which is down there, that really serves us well and also allows for, in that open space, some special activities for seventh and eighth grade advisory. So obviously, as you can see, we're using that space quite well. It allows now the middle school, I think, to be in good shape for the foreseeable future. We have a configuration in our schools, K-4, 5-8, and 9-12. This way of organizing our schools is extremely important to us for a variety of reasons. One, in the area of assessment and curriculum, we work in a collaborative environment. It's important for our teachers that are assessing students, whether it be in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, to communicate with one another. The new legislation under the learning results requires us to create a local assessment system and to have those grade levels together so that they can collaborate in creating these assessments, they can dialogue about curriculums is extremely important. Many of the activities that go on in our schools in the area of improving instruction also is a collaborative type environment. Concord School, for example, the last couple of years they've been involved with something called lesson study. That is a process where teachers observe each other in classrooms, they meet in small groups to critique the lessons, they videotape each other in classrooms, and they meet talk about what they saw, they reteach the lessons. That couldn't be done if we had classrooms spread throughout the district. That communication between the first grade teachers and the second grade teachers, the kindergarten to the first grade, is extremely important to the way that we operate our program. Also, with the kindergarten being placed at the high school, I don't think we get an argument from too many people that good idea that kindergarten be with the elementary school. It should be part of the elementary school. But what they miss out on are some of the assemblies and programs. Unfortunately, with the weather we have today, it's to bundle up the kindergartners to travel down to Pond Cove. It takes a bit of time, and it's something that we don't do that often. Access to the library, those kinds of issues. And just all the activities and programs that are happening in Pine Cove, they sometimes miss out on. And also just the fact that developmentally, that's where they should be. That there was space at the high school, but we need our 4, 5, and 6-year-olds all together in the same space. And again, the climate and culture that we are trying to create in our schools, not only for the adults that are working in this kind of learning community, it's important also for us to have our students be in a culture that the primary word is community, that we're all in this as a school. The kinds of things that we want to work with students about, respect, about working with each other, whether you're in first grade, second grade, or third grade, we want to have these grade spans together so that they begin to see themselves as a culture and a learning organization. It provides those opportunities for grade levels to work together. There are many times when we'd like to have our second and third grade working together on something, or the third and fourth grade, or the kindergartners and the first grade. And at times we have fourth graders working with first graders. That whole kind of environment is important for us as a school community. And lastly, some of the facility problems that are obvious with the kindergartners at the high school, that I need to say that the high school students have been just wonderful. They've been an asset in this time that the kindergartners have been at the high school. But it is a situation where we have kindergartners needing to walk down a flight of stairs to get to the playground. They have to walk through part of the high school to get to the nurse's office. They don't have their own office at the school. For some of those facility issues, where if they were at Pine Cove, obviously it would go away. That they would have their own office that's part of the elementary school. Their own nurse's office, which is something they could access. Those kinds of issues. We've been very fortunate, though, that the situation at the high school has been a very welcoming one, and I think it's a very positive one for the students. But our needs are such that
I'm going to talk a little bit about how education has changed since the early 70s when our high school was first built. The first very obvious thing is that education philosophy has changed. In the 60s and 70s, our school witnessed an educational philosophy that valued an open structure to education. Schools were built with open classrooms and campuses with a greater degree of flexibility to both students and teachers regarding curriculum, class structures, and use of time. At our high school, during this time period, teachers and students could come and go based on their schedules. Teachers did not have their own classrooms. Students could go off campus for lunches and study halls. Today, our students, with the exception of senior privilege, remain on campus throughout the day, placing a greater demand on the library, study halls, cafeteria, and classrooms in general. Our administrators try to give each of our teachers their own classrooms for teaching, planning, conferencing, and paperwork. Experience has indicated that this structure has worked best for providing the higher academic standards that are required for our high school graduates. Next, special education, as mandated by the federal government, has certainly changed since the 70s. Legislature over the past 30 years has required us to offer services for special education students that we did not have in the past. We have a wide range of special needs students, all requiring different services that require additional space, teachers, supplies, and training. In previous years, these students were not educated in our public school buildings, and therefore our school was not designed to adequately accommodate their learning needs. Title IX, which was the legislation that expanded athletics for girls, also had an impact on education. And the impact was not only on our budgets, but also on our space. Today we are proud of our athletes, both male and female, and the skills that they carry forth after their athletic experiences.
When our school was built, we did not have a dedicated athletic director with office and support staff. Storage of equipment did not include space for expanded girls programs, and our fields and gyms are currently utilized to the maximum by both the schools and community groups, stressing both the wear and tear and the scheduling of our spaces. Curriculum needs and advances in science have certainly affected education. If you were to look at what science teaches today, you should not be surprised that the breadth and content of what we attempt to teach students has increased. Environmental sciences, marine biology, specialties that which are very real to our community and state, are taught to our high schoolers. Advances in core sciences such as chemistry, genetics, biology, physics have also changed in what our high schoolers need to graduate. The way in which science is taught has been greatly changed. In addition to the way most of us remember with the use of books and tests and handouts, the impact of real hands-on labs makes science come alive with lasting impressions that enhance the teaching of science and emulate the real-life work of scientists. A little bit about advanced placement programs. As a community that's proud of the percentages of our children that pursue higher education, we look to make sure that they are prepared with the coursework that helps them achieve their goals in terms of admissions. Many colleges require advanced placement courses at the high school level from students they would consider into their programs. As we look to educate every student to their capability, we do have a responsibility to offer some advanced placement courses to those who are beyond our standard curriculum. Another change since the 70s has been the expanded guidance and social services at all of our schools. Guidance departments are more than what many of us remember them. Today's college candidates apply to more colleges with extensive application needs that can only be fulfilled by our guidance staff. This has put increasingly larger demands on our staffing and office needs. Our social services that must be offered in our schools deal with many special ed services for our students, along with substance abuse, single family issues, etc. We also offer a change in the expanded languages as our society becomes more global. In order to better prepare our youth to deal with what has evidently become a more global political, business, and social world, students quite often take not only more years of language than they used to, but many will take advanced placement and even a second language. Minimum requirements have also increased as required by new graduation requirements. Learning results in our state level now require foreign language to be started at earlier grades. This in turn requires more advanced foreign language courses at the high school level. Health and drug, alcohol abuse, anti-smoking, sexual abuse, character development, multicultural awareness, environmental education, all these things are not individual course offerings, but these are topics that our society now expects public schools to address with our students. These require teacher expertise and training, space, and time requirements. Alternative programming is related to the concept that we do have students who do not learn in the conventional way. Some schools have departments with specialized curriculum addressing alternative learning. Other students have the opportunity to attend paths that builds upon the non-traditional academic offerings. Community service is another alternative learning experience that expands upon the what, how, and why our students learn. While some of these programs can require additional space, for Cape Elizabeth, it has been a reallocation of space that needs to be flexible. We also have an increase over the last 30 years in our graduation requirements, so we are offering a variety of different courses and more years of the same courses so that our students can just graduate from the high school. As you guys may be aware of, and have heard us talk about the learning results that are mandated by the state, so that we are offering an expansion of several programs, particularly arts, our foreign languages, our technology, and student assessments, and those put demands on the course offerings in the space. And most recently, our No Child Left Behind Act. That's something that we need to plan for and what the implications are for our students and
how we teach them.
Just briefly, how that space, and to piggyback on what Elaine was speaking about, the number one influence on space that's different today is special education, which is 13% of our student population. I'll note also that the state average for special education is 17% of our student population. In some of the urban areas, is close quite a bit higher. In Pond Cove, for example, we presently have 10 teaching spaces. Now, some of those spaces are small spaces that could not be a classroom. Couldn't turn that space into a classroom. Square footage-wise, it's the equivalent of 5 classrooms. But in looking at that space, there might be 2 spaces that could be used as classrooms. In the middle school, we have 7 teaching spaces, which also has the equivalent of 5 classrooms. Both Pond Cove and the middle school, when they were renovated, they were renovated with those special needs spaces in mind, which is something when we get to the high school, the building that we have is the building that was there back in 1970 without special education. So what's happened at the high school, special education has actually taken over regular size classrooms. So we've taken regular size classrooms, put up partitions, and we've lost the equivalent of 5 classrooms, 5 full-size classrooms at the high school. And looking at both special education at just that Cape Elizabeth High School, in 1970, we had 0 classrooms for special education. And in 2004, we will need 5 full-size classrooms. Maybe divided up, but 5 full-size classrooms. Computer rooms were also something that we did not have in 1970, which in 2004, and as we do, we have a Mac lab, we have a computer lab by the library, and a math computer lab for 3 classrooms. And as you can see, our 1970 school population of 688 was able to get by with 40 classrooms. 2004, with a population that will be 600 students, we will have 32 available classrooms. Special needs and computer alone occupy 8 classrooms, which is approximately 1/5 of the available classrooms.
So the question comes up about why do we need to renovate the high school? There's no denying, the high school will be 35 years old and it's one of the most heavily used buildings in our community. The expectation that major system problems will start appearing is inevitable. When you delay updates and renovation, it will contribute to further deterioration of systems, increased renovation costs, and disruption to the delivery of quality of education. I guess one of the points we wanted to make here is that when you have system breakdowns, such as the recent leaking of some of the plumbing that we had, you have to be in classrooms, and it's not an ideal situation as far as delivering the quality education that we all look to strive for. The renovation costs will increase because you're not getting bids, and you're having to solve the problem immediately. The next one is that the fact that during the past 35 years, the town has bonded approximately $300,000 for roof repair, new phone system, asbestos removal, and new exterior doors. The major system updates that are included in this recommendation include heating and ventilation to 35-year-old systems, plumbing, electrical upgrades, a communication system that would include an updated phone system, putting a phone in every classroom, and with an intercom system for safety, and then exhaust and dust collection in our industrial technology wing. Our gym floor is due for replacement just based on wear and tear. We have one more sanding that can be done on that floor before it is taken down to the cement level. And we have delayed that for, I think, the past 2 or 3 years in hopes that the renovation project would take care of that. But we are dealing with health and safety reasons on the quality of the floor, and that is something that would be included in the project. Our track is 17 years old, It was patched in 1996 because of some problems with the surface, but it definitely needs a complete resurfacing in order to continue to host meets and provide safety for not only our students, but many of the community users. One of the other interesting facts is that you've probably been reading in the media that there are many surrounding communities who are experiencing much of the same situation that we are with our school buildings because they were built around the same period. Yarmouth is spending $15 million on their high school, which is only 2 years older than ours. And you can back out $2.5 million out of that figure because they are building a new auditorium. Both Scarborough and South Portland are undergoing major renovations to their school buildings, both elementary and high school. There's also a need to address life safety issues, such as ADA issues, sprinkler system that has been required by the town fire department, intercoms, and code compliance as regulated by law. And then as we've kind of alluded to previously, that there are three key programming areas that have changed dramatically in the last 35 years, science, computer technology, and special ed have requirements that need to be updated. And then lastly, our cafeteria is not large enough to allow all students to sit during lunch and is undersized for high school events. I just wanted to talk a little bit about that in saying that currently the cafeteria does not have enough seating for the number of students attending their lunch periods. We have students sitting on the floors and hallways and others sitting on heating registers along the wall. We have lost seating from the 1970s when lunch service consisted of a single line and lunch window delivery of a single choice lunch to the current a la carte lunches that are offered today. Food delivery has spilled out into the old seating areas via tables, allowing student choices, quicker line movement, and a higher profit margins for our lunch program. The current scheduling of classes offers only two lunch periods per day. The cafeteria is open less and puts half the population in this space at any one time. This differs from the three lunch periods and the open cafeteria that we had in the 70s. Secondly, the space is also used for a variety of special events. There are parent nights, open houses, team dinners, science fairs, jazz cabarets. It's used for summer recs, scouting events, pool parties, study halls, and those events all struggle to house all the participants. The only larger space may be the cafeteria at our Pond Cove Middle School, which is already being overscheduled.
Some important considerations. This year, to accommodate the large freshman class, we were forced to convert our math lab into a classroom. As a result, the students are currently using a mobile lab, which at best has been a poor substitute. The lab was also used by many other students for general computer time, which is now not available to them. By the fall of 2004, due to the size of the incoming freshman class, which will be the current seventh grade, we are again faced with a lack of classroom space. At that point, our only option will be to move the kindergarten from the high school to provide the three additional classrooms needed to absorb this large incoming class. Our options to facilitate the move of the kindergarten are twofold. If the construction is approved this spring for the addition of Pond Cove, this new space will be ready to use by the fall of 2004. However, if the construction is approved at a later time, or not approved at all, we will need portable classrooms. Number one, if the project is approved at a later time, the portables would be placed at the high school during the construction of the project. Within the first year, we would be spending $52,000 for portables, and the second year, $32,000. Second, if the Pond Cove project is not approved, then portables will be needed at Pond Cove indefinitely. every year after that would be $35,000. These costs are varied based on the decision and the timing of the final decision.
I think the toughest question for all of us is, what is the financial implications of our project? The proposed PONCO project will cost us approximately $1.5 million. Now, the first year of the debt service payment for the 20-year project, bonded project, is approximately $117,000. Now, if that project is bonded next year, we will be retiring school debt and can offset the project by almost $116,000. The second year of the project, the additional cost will be almost $26,000. At the same time, the school department will also be retiring school debt by $27,000. By the third year of the project, the debt service will start decreasing by $3,700, and we will also be retiring additional school debt of $10,000, and that will decrease over the length of the bond over the next 20 years.
Excuse me, Polly, can I just ask a question? I want to make sure I understand. So year one, the cost would be, for the addition, would be $117,000. And then year two, would the cost be $26,000, or would it be $117,000 plus the $26,000?
It would be an additional $26,000 added to the $117,000.
So the cost for the bonded amount would be whatever the total of those two numbers.
Right, the debt service total would be the total of those two for that year.
Okay. And then the cost would be the
decreasing
net of those three numbers.
Correct.
It would be 117 plus 26,000.
Then it would
minus
decrease by 47,000. Correct.
Okay.
Now, if the project is not approved, as Marie has talked about the cost of portables, next year there would be no cost to us for portables for Pond Cove. In 2004-05, we would have to place portables at Pond Cove, and that cost would be $85,000. In the second year, the lease would be $35,000 for every year thereafter.
So, if I could just ask one more question, unless you want me to hold questions for the end. Okay. So in comparing sort of the two halves, the cash flow cost, if the portable thing was done, would be $85,000 in year two versus the cash flow cost would be $142,000 that year.
That's correct. In 2004-05.
And then the next year it would be about $138,000 versus $35,000.
Correct.
That's right. Okay.
Now, with the high school, the projected cost is $7.5 million. In year one, the debt service payment on the 20-year bond would be $219,000 approximately. It depends when we go out to bond. But year two would be an additional $526,000. And in year three, we would start decreasing the debt service payment for 20 years.
Is that an additional, I'm sorry. Is there a way to flip back? Technology. Great, thank you. So year one, the cost in dollars would be for just the high school would be $219,000. Year two, it would be about $750,000.
Yes.
Year three, it would be about $730,000.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
We would like to come back to this point right here and stand to this slide at the end of the evening and discuss our plan to jointly move forward and how we might discuss the specific timelines for each of these projects. Keeping in mind that we have that we need to have a space for the kindergarten in the fall of 2004, and at that same time, our high school will be approaching 35 years old. So right now, I would like to give you a little background on the seventh grade project that you're about to see. Everyone here is aware of the fact that all of our seventh graders received laptops this year funded by the state. What you may not be aware of is exactly what they are doing with them and how important this group of seventh graders are to their peers. During this past summer, Nancy Hutton and Gary Lanois formed a group of about 20 to 30 seventh graders who would receive training and become members of the I-Team. These students helped their classmates with the training of the laptops and continue to help them solve everyday problems in the classroom. Our seventh grade teachers also went through similar training sessions as well. 11 students from the I-Team were nominated by their teachers to be part of this project, and the 9 that are here tonight took on this huge task. Holly Smeebod worked with each of the kids to put a storyboard together and organize the project for the entire week. Holly is a relatively new teacher to our school system and is our computer lab technician. Nancy excused these students from their classes for 5 days in order to put this project together. Elaine, Susan Steinman, and myself gave the kids several newspaper articles and asked them to obtain the rest of the information by interviewing staff, students, and parents at both the high school and Pond Cove. Our only role was to get them to the right places at the right times for their interviews. Their goal was to visually show you, using the technology they have now become so familiar with, why this renovation and building project are necessary. With the expertise of Gary and Holly, the kids were able to put together this presentation for you tonight using iMovie, PowerPoint, and digital photos. I hope you all see how different our kids' school experiences are compared to any of our own. This is a great example of how learning has changed, as well as the kinds of skills that will be needed for this generation to be successful in life. And I will turn this over to Holly Smeebod, who worked with the kids and put everything together that you're about to see.
Just a quick word, my name, as Marie said, is Holly Smeebach, and I manage the computer lab in the middle school. And I was lucky to have the opportunity to work with this talented team, and I wanted to introduce them to you before they set off on their presentation. We have Morgan Alden and Alex Karen. And why don't you guys sort of wave in the back, Tom Michaud, Andrew Nelson, Nick Whiteman, and over there, we have Kirsten Brown, Rebecca Simmons, Ashley Barnett,
and Charlie's here.
And Charlie Gabrielli. And after we were done with the project, it was one condensed week altogether. The kids elected the presenter, who will be Morgan, and Alex is the sound engineer.
Two key areas of the project are renovations of the high school and moving the kindergarten to Palm Cove, which will require an addition. The King Elizabeth High School needs the space where the kindergarten is right now, and also because the building was built in the 1960s and is also in need of improvement.
the new class gets here, the seventh graders, we're going to be having 50 more students here at the high school. So we either have to significantly increase a class size to accommodate those 50 additional students, or we have to get some additional space, which means the kindergarten space. Our facilities up to speed with the instructional techniques, which emphasize technology and lots of hands-on work. And then science, again, is a huge area where there have been some major changes in the way science is instructed, and it's an effort to bring the facilities up to par so that they're compatible with some of those new instructional strategies.
It used to be that science classes were much more lecture and more demo, but now the science reform has students doing far more labs and having the students do the hands-on. And that's really powerful to have the class be able to be in a classroom format and then in a lab format and go back and forth as you need to. We visited 3 different schools to look at the way science labs were built in schools that have just been built. More equipment, more storage, easier access to getting to the lab stations, all of them are important in science classes now than 30 years
ago. A vast expansion of our arts programs, I think, since the school was opened. And that's another area where we've not had any systematic response to the fact that we have a flourishing music, arts, theater program, and the effort is to bring the space in line with that program.
The issues are that we need space. We need a facility. You see a wonderful auditorium, you see a great stage, but for every person that's on the stage, there are at least 2 people off the stage. Those people need a place to work. With this plan, we will have a support system in space to produce the good things we produce on this program.
I think making the high school compatible with the increased use of technology, and making sure that we address the needs of special services students.
And I can assure you that everything in this building, as far as the structural components, are safe. The building was looked at by some structural engineers. Some minor issues were noted and corrected immediately by the school system.
Actually, probably a lot of the things that need a whole lot of work are the things that are kind of invisible, the pipes, the wires. And there's a lot of pipes and wires work that's going to be involved in this project.
The mechanical systems are original systems installed in the late 60s and have pretty much come to the point where they need to be replaced throughout the facility.
We just don't have enough parking. During the school day, and we certainly don't have enough parking after the school. And another one that to a lot of people, doesn't sound really all that dramatic, but it would make a huge difference to allow teachers to have phones in their rooms so that they can call parents, not have to wait for the 2 phones that are in the building that teachers can right now access.
It's the best place in the world. They're great people here. Growing up here, it offers everything that I've ever wanted. Great school system, great support system all the way through. I wouldn't go anywhere else to raise my family.
We also talked with Claire Bree, who is the Special Education Administrator. And basically what the special ed is more classroom space. They don't have enough space right now. And they also need more new equipment because there are a lot more kids now with special needs that need that equipment. As Mr. Shen said, there is not enough parking at the high school. If you're there when school starts or when it gets out at the high school, you can definitely see that it's way too crowded. The ceilings aren't in very good shape at the high school. Most of these pictures are taken in the library. There was a really bad pipe leak, and many of the ceiling tiles were just very badly stained. We talked to Scott Shea, who is the gym teacher at the high school, and the gym is in need of some improvement too. The floor is kind cafeteria definitely needs more space. We got some pictures during lunchtime, and you can see it's crowded in the cafeteria. And there are also kids who eat their lunch out in the halls because there's no room for them to eat. We interviewed some high school kids, and they agreed they can't find chairs or tables to sit at for lunch. In the top picture, it shows two ladies, and they are at their office desk area, and they basically work in the storage area because there's no other place for them to work, and there's no other place for that equipment to be stored. They store the soccer goals in there, the cross-country skis. There's just no other place to store them. And the bottom picture shows a hallway pretty close to the gym, where they also store equipment. The band room also needs more space. There isn't enough room to store all the instruments, so they're all packed into the band room where kids are supposed to be playing. The science labs need a lot of improvement. The top picture and the bottom left picture show the sinks. They're really old and rusty and need to be replaced. And also the bottom right picture shows a storage room for one of the science labs. And that's basically the entire storage room. It's definitely not that big and not enough space for all the science needs. So altogether, the high school needs more space for the cafeteria. The gym floor needs to be replaced. Parking needs to be expanded. There needs to be ADA mandated access areas for people with special needs. The science labs need to be updated. The art program needs more space and more resources. There's not enough room to store art easels and all of their equipment. There needs to be more phones in the high school. There are only two for teachers to use now. It would be great to have more. And also the mechanics of the high school and storage. For the pond cove, it needs an addition so we can bring the kindergarten over here to pond cove. This is the kindergarten wing right now at the high school, and it is needed for classroom space.
The kindergartens at the high school, for very practical purposes, because of the enrollment 10 or 15 years ago, Pond Cove needed the room way back then, and the high school, because of its enrollment, had the space to do that. So the kindergarten became the kindergarten wing at the high school.
I think that the kindergarten should be moved to Pond Cove because you get to do gym, music, and stuff.
But even when it was moved over there many years ago, there was an assumption that it would eventually come back to Pond Cove.
One of the reasons we did select Cape Elizabeth is because of the excellent reputation for their school system. I just feel that kindergarten belongs with an elementary school, and that if my children could go to school with 6-7-year-olds for kindergarten, be in the same environment, it would be great.
There were some issues with this building relative to whether or not it met code to be a school building. Kindergarten classrooms need to be on grade level, which certainly posed a problem in that half of this building is one story up. So that was one of the issues. There are also some fire code issues as well. So it would have taken a lot of money to adapt this building to be a school building.
Here are some pictures of kindergarteners where they are now. Even down at the high school, there isn't enough space for them. In the bottom picture, they show a storage area where kids also work if there isn't enough room in the classrooms available for them. So a Pond Cove summary is that the kindergarten needs to be moved to Pond Cove because high school needs the space. Also, probably would be better for kindergarten that it is to be with first and second graders instead of high school students. There aren't any classrooms at Front Cove for kindergarten now, so there needs to be an addition built. And community center here is not an option for the kindergarten to be located.
I think the laptops are probably the reason we've got an opportunity to do the project, because people on the school board had the confidence in us to give us a chance to really demonstrate what the students have been learning and what they know how to do with the laptops. Sometimes in school we don't get a chance to always demonstrate our knowledge except on a test, and this is just a live demonstration with a presentation of all the things that you know how to do with the laptops. So I think they were a catalyst in getting us a chance to be involved in the project, but it's about much more than the laptops. I think so far they have learned things. I've read that they've learned about storyboards and what storyboards are and how you use those to help plan a presentation. Yesterday, because they did a lot of filming at the high school, they also had a chance to really go down to the high school and see the area. We'd had a water leak, so many of them wrote that they thought the high school was in a mess yesterday, physically, and that they hoped it would be fixed before they got there. I think throughout also they're learning a lot about what the building project is and what the proposals are for the new construction at Pond Cove and for the renovation at the high school.
I'm not a big fan of the laptop project, and since the laptops arrived in middle school, I've become much more of a proponent, having seen the work that you guys were able to do with this stuff. That was really excellent. As for my question, I'll direct it initially to Morgan, but anybody can jump right on in. You guys will be headed for the high school in about a year and a half. What surprised you the most as you went through the high school making your presentation? Or what bothered you the most?
I think the cafeteria was a little surprising. I never really knew that there wasn't enough space, but it's obviously the dire need of it. I don't think I'd want to really have lunch in the hall.
Also, as you're walking through the halls, I mean, even just not even in the lunch periods, you'd have to step over kids who were doing work out in the halls and the floor. And I mean, that doesn't seem like any fun at all.
I thought the library and the pipe situation was pretty surprising because I go to the library a lot and I don't want to be there and have like the pipes burst or something all over me, because I talked to one of my friends and they said that they were like right there when it burst.
Thank you again. Work is excellent.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks to all of you. Thanks for coming tonight and for all of the parents. And actually, if we would give you this opportunity, if you wanted to leave, the next person up is our architect with all of the plans for the high school and Pine Cove, You are welcome to stay, so it is up to you.
Good evening. I'm not sure I'm going to go through all the details, but the lion's share of them are welcome. I'm going to start with a context map. We're going to focus on, I think I'll first talk a little bit about the elementary school. It's the easier one to kind of get a handle on. And then we'll work our way into the high school. But this diagram gives you a good sense of the project or focus areas around the site, and touching upon little pieces and parts. The Punco Elementary School's addition is essentially a classroom addition. It's a rather simple, straightforward solution. And it's conceived as a simple addition that would head on out away from the core of the building into the playground area. It's about 8,800 square feet, single story, would house five classrooms, and a few support spaces, a couple of group rooms, teacher's room, and an OT area. The intention here is to build a one-story structure capability of supporting a future addition. It's important that this location is, it's important that this addition is located where it is so to take care of a number of things that come together in this location. We've looked at other spaces, places around the building. Things get a little remote, removed. We lose opportunities to kind of bring together in a larger sense, all these functions into one area that's kind of the center or the heart of Pond Cove. This addition also takes advantage of the elevator that's in place there should a second story get built there. There's a lot of redundant things that can happen if the addition is put in this location. It takes advantage of being in close proximity to the cafeteria and the gym. Mechanical systems are relatively close by, so it's a good mix, and also puts the kindergarten program in close proximity to the administration facility within the building.
Sorry, maybe I'm getting a little bit.
We all are. Okay. So it's an addition. Comes out about 100 feet, 75 feet wide, five classrooms. As I mentioned, it would be sized and built to handle a second story. At the time of construction, the roof, as we know it normally, would be instead of putting insulation directly on the metal deck, we'd be putting a concrete deck up there, preparing it for the handle of that load.
Would the intent of the second floor be if we ever went to full day K?
Yes.
Because I was just confused by what Sue Weatherby said about kindergarten has to be a grade. So could we have kindergarten classrooms up there on the second floor?
No, but you could
move out of
it. Could
be another grade level.
Could move out of other parts of the building.
But it would be there for if we were to use the expansion. Or
no, I understand that, but I just picked up what she said in the seventh grade presentation.
There are ways to put a kindergarten on a second floor. The code was changed 2 years ago to allow certain provisions to allow them.
So it's not the law anymore?
It's more expensive to do it that way. There are ways to do it now. Okay. All right, that's Pond Cove, pretty straightforward. I do have a simple elevation as if the second story was on the building. The reason we illustrated it this way was to give you a sense of the massing of the building so that you could envision that second story. It's built into a slope of the land outside the building now, the playground area is up here and slope down towards the circle in that location. So it'd be something like that with a second story in there. And if you were in the playground area from the library looking down, you'd see something like this. It's just a relative sense of mass. I'm not saying this is exactly what happens, but relatively, the mass of the other goes on. Be akin to the size and scale, obviously, of this part of the code. Okay, any questions about some of the program or the physical arrangement? Physical arrangement? Parking spaces, additions to the track area, additions to the building, changes in circulation up front, things of that nature. Those were refined, the scheme before us tonight, where, as you can see, there's less site work going on. Primarily takes place where we're dealing with a realignment of the front entrance, a realignment and change to the circular pattern here, the rotary pattern there, a new parking area in this location, actually just expansion of parking on either side of the drive, the addition that goes on at the front of the building, this location, primarily to gain ADA access to the building, that's ramped to the front doors, is almost twice, maybe more than twice as steep as required, as necessary, as required by code. Access to the lower area here and some defined ADA access route. Out towards the west side of the building, athletic field here. This little diagram gives you an idea what the present field layout is, and that's this line I'm tracing here. This new field would be obviously a little bigger, regulation size field. And along with that, taking advantage of what is used now as a parking area on gravel, de facto it's poorly organized, but organizing parking here and in this location on the left side of the drive access running to the back. This diagram shows us that we have essentially two additions, and I mentioned the front door addition, so to speak, and the cafeteria addition.
Could you explain how cars would come in and drop off? I mean, eliminating the circle, and how would cars move?
Conceptually, yes, I'd be glad. The problem with the circle is that people stop in the circle because it's easier just to keep on going around the circle and go back out. That causes traffic to back up all the way out onto 77, and then once they're on backed up that way, any cars trying to get in are stopped on 77. The original conceived idea of circulation in the front of the building was actually a drop-off lane along that whole front of, by the library. And indeed, the very earliest drawing showed that this parking arrangement and driveway extended way out down in this location and back up. That was essentially so buses could line up. What we've done here is reinforce that theme, letting people come in, and then they must turn left, and they'd have to queue along here to drop off people, passengers. And then they'd proceed back out as they do now, and up to that location, turning right. This would let the traffic flow more smoothly to the right so that it doesn't back up onto 77. There's a lot of work has to go through that with traffic studies and understanding what the real geometric patterns are and the radius we're going to give everybody. But the civil engineers have worked out a scheme that I think solves a lot of that congestion.
Two quick questions. The earlier presentation mentioned track being worn out 17 years. You haven't colored that in. Is that no longer part of the plan?
I haven't colored it in. It is labeled C7 and shows up on the in the pricing and the description of the work.
So it is still
part of it. It is still part of the work, yes.
Second question, the students and the other presentations identified the cafeteria space need. Is the amount of space that's being designed for the cafeteria the result of an analysis of how much space is actually required? Will that fit the need once that addition is put on so those conditions of the kids in the hall and some of those other issues will be fully alleviated?
Yes. What we've tried to do is identify what was the usable area of the cafeteria, presently usable area. Not what it was designed for, because for what it was designed for, if you went marching through the past the food line, got your tray slapped with a sloppy Joe and you went on, that didn't take up much floor space off the front. But as it's configured now, a good portion of that originally designed floor area is taken over by food service programs. And it's pushing the kids to one end of the building, one end of the room. So what we did, we took a look at the projected enrollment, what would ideally be, according to state standards, what would be the size of cafeteria would be desirable, what area do we need for seating, more precisely. That's what gave us the footprint for the addition. We said we need some space. It's a little larger than you might program at the state level for state standards, but those state standards are also 30-year-old standards. So I think there's good justification for the size of the space there. The addition is not just an addition where it's a way to get into the building too. It includes a vestibule, a way to enter the building from the back of the from this parking lot. So you're not coming up through the building. There's direct access, better control that way, for after hours or whatever summer rec programs. So the other parts of the building closed off. So we've given it a little bit of a front door, so to speak.
Bob, while you're on that, could you comment about the discussion we had in the Building Advisory Committee regarding the heating system and the need to change that wall anyway?
As you're probably all aware, if you're in the high school, there are all these baseboard radiation units around. Well, they're unit ventilators. They're kind of big boxes that sit on the side of the building. They are a first response and a cheap response to treat almost any space. They don't balance well. They have a limited life cycle. That is probably in the vicinity of 20 to 24 years. They can limp along for a long time afterwards and not function very efficiently. And in the high school, they're basically used as a counter to sit on, to eat at. And a lot of classrooms, they end up being places where you just put things on for books, things like that, so they're not working very well anyways. They're supposed to be taking in fresh air from the outside, heating it, dumping it into the space. That's not a very good way to treat air either, to bring it directly inside, try to heat it up real quick, especially when it's cold. You should preheat it before it gets to that coil. Those units are going to be taken out, and we are going to replace the heating system or the air handling system for the cafeteria with a new unit on the roof so that it's quieter, it's more easily serviced. Very longer lifespan for the machinery in that location. So that's one of the things we're going to improve, environmentally improve the space. The second component is wall there is what's commonly called a curtain wall. Very popular from about, it was really an invention that falled out of aircraft, aluminum, use of aluminum during World War II, and how you can infill a wall with aluminum, which is very conductive, of single pane glass that has absolutely no coefficient of heat resistance. So pretty soon you've got an assembly that does pretty good things keeping air out, but it doesn't do very well cold or balancing the air or controlling the heat or gain or loss. Heat gain is actually quite severe in its exposure to the south there. That is a hot wall. The caulking goes in the joints of those curtain walls in about 30 years. It's slightly less, actually. I looked at a school in Southport, and this whole building is like that, and it's already been re-caulked once, and it is only 35 years old. So the idea there is to replace that curtain wall system. Therefore, we control the environment inside a little better. We give some solar protection. We certainly make it more, the air handling system run more efficiently. So that's the environmental condition of that space. I had the joy of being in there this summer, and it was a hot summer, as you know, and that was a warm space. Any other questions?
How many parking spaces are there total now? And then how many are you supposed to be added?
Well, I don't have them off the top of my head. I can look for them and get back to you on that. I know I have them with me. That's something I remember about.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Talk about the parts and pieces in Friday. Start down on what we refer to as the first floor part one. You have diagrams of this. But this is the industrial arts wing, so to speak. And it's a space that we spend a number of hours with the teachers and trying to understand what their needs were and to better assemble their, or group their spaces together. One of the activities that we were heavily involved in early on, last winter and early spring, was going with meeting with each teacher and really discussing what kind of relationships they need in their department with other teachers in their department. Trying to bring a synergy together so that they're all working close proximity as a department. So they're delivering a program that really reflects what they have envisioned in their curriculum. Starting down here, you can see we've made some, this is the music rehearsal room. There's no major change in that, but this diagram essentially says the magenta areas are where we're going to start reassembling or redefining those spaces. The stage is here. We need a stage craft area. Right now, this is the way you get into the music rehearsal room. And there's a green room, a need for a green room. Stagecraft now is done in a room that is, maybe 15 by 18. And if there's anything going on in there, you can smell it throughout that wing of the building, that is pain or any of those activities. You need a ventilation system in order to conduct that type of work, those activities. There's a costume and prop storage space. Right now, it's stored down on the same floor, but down around the corner, well away from the stage itself, down here, along with where paper was stored and school supplies were stored. So that's been brought around towards the stage, so it's more convenient for them to access that equipment. Music storage is a great deal. That's presently identified to go in a place that there's an ensemble room, that location to be changed to just pure music storage. So lots of instruments that are left out and around or stored, need a home. What that does here is mean, well, it means a couple of things. What happens to the ensemble space, which is too small for ensembles? It really is. If you walk into that space, you have to stand, you know, have to step over the drums, and you have to wiggle around the organ. So we've given it a larger space here and actually taken over the space that was once part of the art program. And that becomes the ensemble area with some practice rooms off of it. And then some of that art program is then pushed right down towards the end of the building where we have the darkroom remains, but then we have a photo classroom right next to it and a large room for drawing and painting in this location. Actually, taking good advantage, it's here now, but it takes advantage of the north light. The computer functions that go here are moved across the hall into a space that has some electronics in it now, but probably not well suited for it because it's so close to both the industrial technology and the general lab and the workshop area that it probably needs a better environmental control, judging by the equipment that's kept in there. So that's where the computer drafting and room would be. Along with this, there are other renovations going on, not just the reorganization of the classrooms, but the mechanical and electrical systems, an all-new intercom system, and an all-new phone system. We regularly, for the school projects we've been involved in the last several years, every classroom gets their own phone. It's a combination phone and intercom system, digitally controlled. That type of amenity throughout the building.
What is a green room?
A green room? I've never been in theater, but the best I know about green rooms is that's where you, I guess, comes from people getting, you know, getting ready to go on. So
makeup.
You're standing there waiting for your line to come out, to get behind the curtain, to get on, you're practicing your lines at the last minute. I really don't know, but that's where their final preps are going on before they hit the stage.
You do that, Henrik?
Here's Johnny.
That's right. that's where he would be in the green room. Now this is part two of the first floor. This is the cafeteria. This is the cafeteria as we know it now. We've identified this as really that portion that we call the food service prep area. It's about 870 square feet. It's a good sized classroom, and more. That's out in front of the kitchen. And the cafeteria addition is in this location. Come down along back here, there are some plans to reclaim some of the storage space. Now that the school supplies are out of there, as general storage, paper supplies are out of there, for general storage, custodial supplies are here, and then there's the ceramics classroom and art studio space here. A little remote, one of the concessions the art department has made, wanting to get this part with the rest of the department, but knowing it was going to have real ramifications, perhaps in another addition down here. They felt that they could survive still with the ceramic classroom there, but better organized, better storage, little separation. As you know, the ceramic area is a pretty dirty space, dusty and dirty, and some ventilation would help. The gym here, a new gym floor. The bleachers are not part of the project, have not been priced. But there is a new floor going in on the gym. And some reorganization along here. This public foyer, while we think of it as rather large, it is really, if you do the math, figure out what the seating capacity is of the gym, seating capacity of the cafeteria, that lobby is marginally okay. One could make an argument if they both were occupied at the same time, that space is too small. So what we're trying to do here is introduce an area for a snack bar, away from here, back in this location, pull the vending machines out of that corridor and put it in a space in that location. obviously there's some weight training PE programs that go on there, and we're looking at including that now down in the locker room area. This whole area for the locker room from the pool side back, not including the pool locker room, the pool side back, 35-year-old equipment, and it's needs a lot of update. And we are looking at wholesale changes to the locker rooms, also adding some, and perhaps downsizing some of the needs for some of the size of some of the locker rooms and finding some storage space there. We think there is some laundry room is oversized. Perhaps one of the team rooms can be given up, a part of the team room, so that we can create some more locker rooms, not more locker, more storage space down there for PE equipment, and get it out of that corridor or combine it with that corridor so that it's more efficient use. The single largest expense in this area was the ventilation. The unit that sits down in this room here must have been built in place. It's not something you would go out and buy. It isn't a factory assembled sealed unit. Somebody was down there with a tin knocker, because otherwise you couldn't fit it in the cavity above the ceiling there. And it is one of the reasons it doesn't work well. It overheats and it has cross pollution in the pool environment. The system is just poorly designed to begin with, and we are looking at rooftop units down here, along with a new roof.
So I guess my original assumption that if it was black, it was going to stay the same, and red, it was going to change, but that's not the case.
No, it's not fully the case. You need to read the description to understand that. The red is areas where we're introducing new walls, or new assemblies, okay, the magenta, okay? And if we have put, if there's some of the program spaces, they indicate program change. This area needs a lot of work, and redesigning it right now is something we're going to have to spend a lot of time figuring out exactly how that would.
You mentioned that the cost that we have do not include the bleacher.
That's correct.
Do you have any estimate on what it would cost for 1,400 seating? 1,400.
Yeah, you're not going to get all that seating capacity back in there due to.
I'm just looking. It says here 300. It looks like 700 on each side.
That's approximately what you have. Not sure you can get all that back in there because of ADA requirements.
Do you have any sense of what the cost would be?
$144,000, I believe. I can confirm that for you.
Approximately how much longer is your presentation?
Not too much longer.
I didn't know people might.
How about 10 minutes?
All right. People might wait that long.
Okay.
Yeah, they're sitting on one of our cost saving measures, so I didn't know.
All right. I'm going to go to the second floor. Second floor is, again, the diagram shows program changes as well as new partitioning. In the description, one of the items that the advisory committee is committed to doing is the special ed suite here and here, and the rest of the classrooms would be unchanged. So we're limiting the amount of renovations to the special ed facilities here and here, plus the bathrooms, goes without saying. plus the bathrooms. That would be the limit of work on the second floor. And on the third floor, then, there are significant changes in that there is a new physics lab being introduced here, but the existing laboratories are also being renovated. One is very early on state admissions to develop these science labs beyond what it was in 1970, develop a more a prototypical lab that would lend itself to the type of teaching they are involved in now, and looking at another physics lab there and clustering them in these pairs. The math rooms are here. Social studies are down here. This used to be the old business administration wing, business classroom wing, sorry. That's why it is configured the way it is. It probably had typing rooms and things of that nature down here. The addition in the front, kind of filling in the inside corner here with a new main entrance so that we can get handicap accessibility to the front door. I know that's been cited in many of the reviews that Jeff has gone through, that you know the building, you can get into the building in a circuitous sort of way, but you should at least have your front door accessible. And in doing that, one of the consequences of this physics labs here, the clustering of the classrooms, is the guidance suite, which is here, moves across to this location, and the administration is here, keeping that relationship between guidance and administration at the front. That's about it. Okay? Any other questions?
I do have a couple of questions. I'm curious if there is a standard square footage per capita per student population and what the current square footage per student compares to that.
The state standards for high school would be somewhere in the 140 to 155 have to check that, but 155 square feet per student.
And what do you have existing?
There is approximately 100 and, not including the pool area, figure on that, but I can get to the school department has it.
Bob, is it 142,000?
Yeah, 140, you said something like that?
142,
oh, yes, it's right on the budget sheet. Yeah, 142,000.
So if it's 155 square feet per
student? I'm not positive of that. I don't know what they're running.
A printout here that says that the overall, the DOE guidelines for gross building area in square feet per student are at high school level, 160 square feet.
160.
So when
the Department of Education looks at these things, they look, it's very hard to look at these numbers because you have some big spaces at the high school that don't make a lot of sense. The gyms and locker rooms really skew all that way up. So I advise you to be careful in assuming that that's a way you derive a high school program.
So 160, if it were 160 square feet times 600 students would be 96,000 square feet.
That would be.
And we currently have 142,000 square feet.
you need to add in multipliers for circulation, boiler rooms, things of that nature. I advise you not to look at that.
And the classrooms in the high school are, again, when they build a new facility, the classrooms are usually smaller.
Classrooms are smaller.
We have one of the larger gymnasiums around. So it's, you have to look at number. I think the thing to look at is the number of classrooms, not the use of classrooms. Because we're not adding any space in the project at all, except for the cafeteria.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, I'm
sorry. What's the second one?
Another question I had was, how long will the addition and the addition of Pond Cove and the renovation to the high school support the projected student population? Have we kind of projected out some timeline versus what we're doing now, and where does that meet?
The enrollment will go up to, from our projections, to approximately 600 students. And if you just follow the classes through, it looks as if it will level off between 550 and 600. That it doesn't, for the long term, we don't see the high school getting any larger than that.
So what we're proposing now, we expect to take us into a decade, a couple decades?
Right, we're not. We know that we have relatively flat enrollment with a slight increase now. That's why we're not looking at, actually the only space we're gaining are three kindergarten classrooms. So this isn't really, it's more about a lot of the mechanical needs and a lot of the systems that are 35 years old than maybe a need for a
renovation.
Right, instead of a need for a lot of space.
Bleacher replacement,
$199,000. When the kids gave their presentation, they talked about the mechanical systems needing to change at all of the schools. Was that accurate? The Pond Cove and the 30th building, are those mechanical systems also, when we did the renovation, weren't those taken care of?
Okay.
I kind of got the sense that they were, everything needed replaced everywhere, but maybe I misunderstood it.
Certainly in the high school, there's just a lot of, we're looking at everything, including mechanical and electrical systems. We're looking at the panel boxes, the feeds to the panels. The number includes a electrical line that's coming down. You're aware of it, comes down here from a transformer pull box and here underneath the tennis court here, and then loops around here. That's the main electrical feed. It includes replacing this underground line up here. They are having trouble with it. They don't last forever. I'm not sure what it's buried in, how it's encased or whatever, but they've been having trouble with that feed. It also includes some hydrants around the site. There's three of them located. It includes a sprinkler system in the building. It's only partially sprinkled in parts of it. Take care of some issues of paper storage. Large storage rooms, or a certain size, need to be sprinkled. But after that, we look at the sprinkler in the whole building. The sprinkler system has to be slightly oversized. We don't have all the water pressure in the world, so you oversize the system to make up for that. Build bigger pipes.
One last question. It sounds like a lot of the high school project really is renovating existing mechanical facilities, but we were also talking about updating the science classrooms and
yes.
laboratories. Does the cost of that renovation include equipping those laboratories?
I apologize, I got a little sidetracked there. My point on the science rooms, we're renovating those rooms. Also, it's all new furnishings, casework, counters, surfaces, storage cabinets. As far as the science department is concerned, most of that stuff can go. A lot of the stuff is built for a different way they work. And the classroom needs reconfiguring, the island arrangements that are different with different classrooms. So we're looking at all the caseworks as well. It doesn't include microscopes, does not include microscopes and things of that type of equipment, but sinks, fume hoods if that's required, and there probably is one or two fume hoods.
neighborhoods that they're looking at, and certainly New Islands, or a bench with an island, a peninsula comes out and students can gather around.
Thank you.
All right.
Maria, did you have follow-up comments at this point, or it looks like everybody just wants to take home and digest it, I believe, probably, but certainly all that day for the questions of Maria, anyone if they're interested.
Are there any other program questions, anything else that we can answer that Tom, or myself, or Lane, or Pauline talked about? If John?
One of the slides, I can't remember who gave it, said that there was no, I think it might have been Tom, no additional classroom space was gained as part of the Pond Cove Middle School 1994 project. What about the top floor of the 30th building? Did we gain space? I know we renovated it later.
Right.
But we did gain, I mean, we've gained space since then. That's kind
of. Since then, that wasn't part of the project.
Right, but we did gain space.
We did gain space.
Classroom space at the middle school.
Yep.
Yes.
Yes, okay. That's
planning on having a walkthrough at all to be able to see these things, to see the condition of the cafeteria and that sort of thing?
We will be happy to take anyone who wants to walk through the schools. We can do that. We can set up appointments individually or as a group, however you would like to do it.
Yeah. I'd like some more information. You may not be able to provide it now, but I'd like some more information on the demographics and the school population stuff, because it was my understanding, I don't know if I'm current or not, but that the SMRT numbers that were done a few years ago, they're the high estimate, that it's running pretty close to that. So is that what you're using for prediction purposes?
Actually, the SMRT booklet, the planning decisions who did that survey for us gave us two models to look at. One was the best fit model, which they considered was the best fit for Cape Elizabeth, and the second was the high model. We have, you know, before the study was even finished, we had surpassed the best fit model with students. So what we have been looking at for the past 2 years is the high model that they gave us. Last year, we were over 30 students higher than that high model. I mean, this year, our current year that we're in right now. And those numbers are coming from Pond Cove and the middle school, not necessarily the kindergarten class itself. You know, everyone talks about, okay, the birth rate and how many kids are coming into our kindergarten and will continue to. For the next 10 years. But we are seeing increases in all grade levels from Pine Cove through the middle school, which is something that has us a little bit, you know, curious as to already in the second year of projections, they're off.
Well, but if I could just add, they're only off by under 2%. So I mean,
no, it may not be significant. That's why I think.
So I'm not sure.
No, it's not significant, but there have been quotes in the newspaper, and a lot of people have been talking about our declining enrollment. And why do we need to do anything when we have a declining enrollment?
Which is
and
why.
And the fact is, we don't have a declining enrollment.
Which is why I wanted to get some more information on it, because I think the counselors will be so sick of me saying that. I think facts are just so persuasive. There's so much stuff you read in the papers that it would be just so helpful for the community at large to know what the facts were. The facts, as I currently understand them, is that the high estimate, and I understand SMRT did sort of two models, the best fit and the high, and that the high estimate is sort of what you guys were basing, you guys meaning the building committee, not the school board, the building committee was basing sort of using for their mental projections for school population. And so far that seems to be running, it's within 30 students. Last year it was off 0.5%. This year it's off 1.5% or 1.7%, something like that, which may or may not be significant. You never know. There's 137 kids in the 12th grade right now, and so assuming that they'll all graduate, you could have up to 137 in the kindergarten coming in, plus whatever you change in the other grades, and have the system be flat. I guess the SMRT numbers, didn't they show that the system population would peak in 2003, 2004, and then start to decline?
No, they showed that our population would peak in 2001, 2002, and then start to decline. And in 2001, 2002, we were slightly higher than their projected numbers. And this year, as I said, 30-some students higher than their projected numbers. So this year,
out of 1,750.
Yeah, 1,752. We currently have 1,783 right now. Last year we had 1,762 against a projection of 1,757.
I guess I just like more information on the demographics, the population. I'm not fully informed on it, and I think it might be helpful for other counselors to sort of know what the predictions are, just to make sure, you know, if the population is flat, like some people think it is, if it's rising like some people think it is, if it's declining, you know, sort of what the predictions are, what the model is that you're using, to make sure that we're, you know, planning for the right
and I think
system
capacity.
You have
to keep in mind that the project is not, unlike other communities like Falmouth or Cumberland, this is not, or Scarborough, the whole project's not an enrollment-driven project. It's driven by the need for renovation and
right.
those kinds of things. So it's not as much enrollment-driven, although COVID enrollment is important because of that kindergarten addition.
I understand right. completely. There are always bulges, you know, bubbles, whether they're Pond Cove, middle school, high school, whatever, moving through the system. I just think it would be helpful to have some information on that.
Okay, well,
to put it in context.
I think all of you did receive the SMRT study, correct? Okay, so that will give you all of the demographics and the projections from now until 2010. What the other information, and you've seen you have in your packet the chart as to where we are current, so you know how many students we have in school. I can then give you a history of enrollment, if you wish, back from 1970 to current. I don't know what else, what other kind of information you would want.
On the building committee, which I served on with Marie and others, we had a population or demographic subcommittee because there was some concern about whether or not the SMRT numbers were valid. And I think after meeting in that subcommittee and meeting with the town manager, looking at the information that we received from the 2000 census, as a subcommittee, we had concluded that the high model was accurate enough to rely on for planning purposes. So,
and that high model shows a peak and then a decline.
Yeah, so I think rather than, I don't think that you're asking for something that we don't have the information on. I think we met as a committee, we looked at it, and we felt that the high model was reasonably accurate and was certainly enveloped by, at one point we even concluded that even if the high model was off by 10%, the numbers were such that you would still be below the numbers that this school had served in the past. So as Tom said, the idea is that this is not being built for new students. And I think in terms of what is it going to look like 5 years from now, we had agreed as a committee we could rely on the high model.
Thanks, Marianne. You know, one other thing that I'll just point out is that in this population projection for the next 10 years, if we were to look at 2010, okay, from where we are today, in 2010, this shows a decline of about 200 students from where we are today in our school system, okay? And what we're saying is that for the past couple of years, we're not on the track with this projection, okay? If you look individually by school, in 2010, with that decline of 200 students, it shows that the high school will have 515 students. Today, we have 554 students, so we're 50 students on. In the middle school, it shows that we will have 491 students. We have 600 students, so we're 200 students off there. In Pond Cove, it shows that we will have 597 students. We have 600 students there. That's if it progresses the way this chart is laid out.
I'm sorry, you said that in 2002-2003 there were 550 students in the high school?
540,
546. And they projected 554.
554, yes. The difference is in the middle school and the Pond Cove.
Okay, but what you said, that's what you just said, that in 2010 it'd be 515, and so there's 50 up. It sounds to me like there's only a couple up. This year, there's only a couple up. They're not 50 up, they're only 4 or 5 up.
The high school to the high school, right?
Right.
550 versus 515.
Right.
So that's 35 students off?
No, because they projected 554.
And
you're at 546. So you're 8 students off. I mean, that's... Are we looking the same page on...
I'm not sure I understand that. I don't understand.
No, that's a 2002-2003 projection.
I think what we need to do is we'll put together some more information on the demographics. I don't know if we can get this tonight.
You know what?
Maybe I misinterpreted. I thought you said they were 50 students off. They're not 50 students off. They're 8 students off.
From this year.
From now to the worst case decline in 10 years.
It's 50 students difference.
You're looking at
2000.
Right.
System 1.
No,
I'm just
trying to decipher
it.
Yeah,
they looked at the historic growth of Cape Elizabeth. They have formulas that they look at historic growth rates. They look at the baby boom. They look at the baby boomlet. All those generations going through the different systems. They look at our growth patterns of number of housing units compared to other communities. They put that all into a computer where they have population projection models, and it spits it out. I served with Marianne on that subcommittee. There are a couple other of the parents here who served on it. And basically, I think that the one sentence I remember most from that is we found no reason to substitute our personal judgments for what they had come up with.
I want to underscore, it's hard to look at those charts in a meeting. I think you really have to go home and study them. The important point to remember is, as a subcommittee, with the town manager, school board, parents, we all agreed that the high model was a reliable number for planning purposes. So you're looking...
No, I just think that the whole enrollment issue right now is so we felt comfortable with the numbers that we didn't have to add on more space to the high school. We didn't need to come to the committee and say, okay, we need an additional wing at the high school for another 7 classrooms. We feel that the space we have is enough space, but it's not, it needs to be renovated and it needs to be divided differently and more usable for today versus 1970. And the space we needed at the elementary school, based on the enrollment projections, that having the classrooms for the kindergarten would serve our needs for the next 10 years based on the high model projections. So it really isn't, I mean, enrollment, we didn't feel like we needed that we were going to need an additional 10 classrooms at Pond Cove as well. That we tried to keep it, we felt comfortable with only adding minimum amount of space based on those projections. And the only space other than the cafeteria is the class, really the classrooms that are being added for the kindergarten to be at Pond Cove, where it should be. But that's just a little personal thought.
So is there information that you want me to get to each of you?
Why don't we check again to see if there are any more materials that gave that subcommittee? Okay, so
Anna, are you satisfied that if the committee
I'm perfectly satisfied I just wanted to confirm. I'm satisfied now. I'm perfectly satisfied that those are the numbers that are being used for planning purposes.
Okay.
I'm perfectly happy with them. I just wanted to know what they were. That's all. And the showed the population up to today, and it would be informative to see the population as predicted by the rest of the model. And I realize from today onward, there might be, you know, actual may not track actually on top of that same line, but it would be helpful to see, because Tom is absolutely correct. Unlike Scarborough, which has had 30% growth over the last 10 years, Cape has had very low growth over the last 10 years and is predicted have very low growth for the next 10, 20 years because the median age of town is rising and so on and so forth. It's getting to be an older town, median age. So.
Yeah, the age bracket that has had the largest growth increase in our town from the 2000 census has been 45 to 54 years old. There has been a 64% increase in that age bracket.
The only reason I bring up this question is that, frankly, other citizens are going to want to know. So it's better to have the information and be prepared, because other people will be asking. I'm reasonably well informed, but there are a lot of people who will want to have those things. Yeah.
But I think to expand on what Marie has said, shared with us, is that the largest growth has been in that particular age category, is what comes along with that age category are our students, because people have delayed having families until later on in life. They're coming in with children into our school system with children who are a little bit older, and that's why we're seeing some of these larger influxes at the middle school level, whereas you used to be able to anticipate your growth at the kindergarten and first grade level. So that's partly responsible for what we're seeing as far as those population growth.
Just one question. One of your PowerPoints, you had a couple of dates of school board workshop, I think, on January 28th,
yes.
And then the workshop on the 30th. What are you expecting at those couple of meetings?
You know, actually, what we expected tonight was to just give you all of this information. And next week, next Tuesday, the school board has a workshop. And we would like to be able to discuss in more detail, because we have not at this point, of what a timeline might look like that we would talk about at the meeting that we have with you on the 30th to discuss the budget and discuss, after you all have digested all of this information, a possible timeline for each of these projects to see if we can come to some agreement or at least further this conversation from tonight. Does that seem reasonable for everyone? Then I think that's where we can end tonight's meeting.
Can I just ask a little bit about the need for the parking, additional parking spaces? How many spaces are available for students now?
You know, I don't know.
Oh, were you just asking about students? Or total? I thought you were asking the total number of parking
spaces. Yeah, Ann did ask that. And I'm not sure how many parking spaces we currently have. But I know that what was to be added in this project were 100 parking spaces. And that number came from a number that's given to us that we need so many parking spaces per classroom in the high school.
Much below.
We are much below. We needed to add 100 parking spaces to get to that level. But Carol, I don't remember what we had.
I can give you some rough.
It's a code, town code.
Existing spaces near Pond Cove, 217.
I'm sorry.
217.
And where is Cove?
Near Pond Cove.
But what about the high school?
High school, 241.
That's what we have?
Community center, 110. Total spaces, 568.
Community center, 110 means the spaces beside us and then the part of the lot?
Yes.
So there's 241 spaces sort of currently produced by high school faculty, visitors, students.
That's right.
Whoever.
Community center does, right. If you, some of the reconfiguration that you're looking at, add approximately 95 spaces.
Actually, Mike, maybe you can answer this. I'm not sure, but I think those numbers that we were given that we needed to add the 100 spaces, was that before community services at the pool took those parking spaces in there?
I don't think it's really accurate to say that it was the exact number determined spaces needed, because the formulas in the ordinances and the guidelines show a number much, much higher than we usually have. The 100 spaces, I think, is an attempt not just to recognize the daytime use, but even more so to recognize the after-hours use, the community use, and the school use of the buildings for evening activities. From the public safety viewpoint, the police and fire, you know, the daytime works fairly well. You know, the principal might differ because he deals with the daily problems. But the what really is the public safety concern and why more spaces are needed is really whenever there's more than one nighttime activity at the school. If there's a pool meet and something in the auditorium, if there's community services classes and there's a basketball game, whenever you have any of those events that attract any interest at all, the parking is woefully inadequate on the high school campus, and to the point of concerns with public safety.
I'll echo that. I think the 100 spaces came out of the SMRT's study as a kind of a program issue from the school side. You know, what do we think we need on an average school day, kind of to fill what an operational type of thing that would be comfortable. It isn't driven by an ordinance.